Welcome back to your free training course for Windows 7. In this video, I will look at creating a remote connection back to your office when you are at home or traveling. With Windows 7, you can use the internet to create a secure connection back to your office. On the other end, you can of course have a Windows server, but a lot of companies prefer to have a hardware solution. There are many devices on the market that support network connections. These devices include firewalls, DSL services, and even more specialized devices such as VPN concentrators. In some cases, you may not have an internet connection where you are and you may want to use dial-up. Hopefully this is not the case, but if you do, Windows 7 supports it. When you connect back to the office, you are more than likely going to use a virtual private network connection or VPN connection. A VPN connection is a secure connection that uses the internet to transfer data between two points. Since the internet is a public network, the data is encrypted to prevent unauthorized eavesdropping. Once the data reaches the VPN device, which can be a hardware device or software such as Windows Server, the data is decrypted. In a lot of cases, the VPN infrastructure will be configured so the user will get the same network experience as if they were connected locally to the network. Of course, the speed will be slower. Although it is possible to have an unsecure connection back to your office, having an encrypted VPN connection does give you a lot of advantages. The encryption feature prevents your traffic from being intercepted, often referred to as eavesdropping. But you also get other features such as integrity checking. Integrity ensures that the connection on both sides is from who it says it's from. This prevents someone impersonating either the server or the client. Lastly, a VPN connection prevents what is referred to as a replay attack. A replay attack is when network traffic is saved by a third party and then played back at a later date. To understand this better, consider this. If you could save the start of a network stream, this usually contains traffic that authenticates the connection, such as usernames and passwords. If a third party captured this traffic, they could resend the data back to the server. Just replaying the start of the connection to the server would then authenticate the third party, and then they could insert any data after that they wanted as that user. The last kind of attack is called the man-in-the-middle attack. The man-in-the-middle attack is when a third party gets in the middle of the connection. From here, they can tamper with your data, insert additional data, or even take over the connection. A VPN connection will encrypt new packets based on the last packet. This makes it impossible to even change a single bit in the data stream. If any data is changed, added, or removed, the packets will be dropped at the other end. Now that you understand the advantages of VPNs, the next thing you need to do is decide which protocol to use on the VPN connection. Windows 7 supports 4 different protocols. The first is point-to-point tunneling protocol, or PPTP. This is considered the weakest VPN protocol because it does not require certificates. This also makes it one of the most commonly used protocols because not requiring certificates makes it easy to set up. To use PPTP, you need to have port 1723 open. Layer 2 tunnel protocol is the next type of protocol that Windows 7 supports. This is an open standard, so is supported by other operating systems on the market and other devices. It uses IPsec for encryption and thus requires certificates to operate. In order to use L2TP, you need to have port 1701 and UDP port 500 open. The next protocol is Secure Socket Tunneling Protocol, or SSTP. This was a new protocol introduced in Windows Vista. It uses SSL for encryption, or in other words, uses HTTPS. Because it uses HTTPS, it runs over port 443, which may already be open on your firewall. The last VPN protocol is Ike version 2. This is new to Windows 7. Ike version 2 supports the new Windows 7 Reconnect feature. Previously with VPN connections, if the connection was to drop out, the user would have to reestablish the tunnel. With the Reconnect feature, this is done automatically by Windows. The advantage of this is that if you were doing a large file transfer over the network, the transfer would not have to be started over again. In order to use the Reconnect feature, you must be running Windows 7 and also connecting to a Windows Server 2008 R2 remote access server. In order to use Ike version 2, you must also have UDP port 500 open. Once you decide which type of protocol you want to use for your connection, you next need to decide on the authentication protocol you want to use. The authentication protocol is used to verify who you are. This can be done using username and password or certificates. The first type of authentication protocol is password authentication protocol, or PAP. This uses unencrypted passwords, and thus you can imagine this is very insecure. By default, PAP is disabled in Windows 7 and Windows Server 2008 remote access. The next protocol is CHAP, or Challenge Authentication Protocol. This is an open standard that works by the server sending a challenge to the client. This is in the form of a hash. The client then uses the password on the hash and responds back with an answer to the challenge. Using this system means the password is not transmitted over the network. Windows 7 does support CHAP, but you will find that it is disabled in Windows Server 2008 remote access by default. It is enabled in Windows 7 by default in case you need to connect to old devices that do not support a newer protocol. The next protocol is MSChAP version 2. This is Microsoft's version of CHAP. It is a challenge authentication protocol like CHAP, but has some improvements making it more secure than CHAP. Since it is a Microsoft protocol, it can also use the currently logged in username and password when establishing a connection. The next protocol has quite a lot to it. EAP, or Extensible Authentication Protocol, as the name suggests, is a protocol that can be extended. The idea behind it is that another protocol can be bolted onto it. The protocol that is bolted on is written in the name. For example, EAP-TLS, a commonly used protocol used with smart cards. The problem with the EAP protocol is it is not secure. If you are using EAP-TLS, then EAP will be used to pass public keys between each part. If a hacker were to intercept these packets, then they could get these public keys. For the hacker to do anything, they would need the private keys, so thus, even though EAP is not secure, TLS is quite secure. If you use some other protocols with EAP, they may or may not be as secure as TLS is. A hacker eavesdropping on the communications may be able to get information such as your username and other data they could use. What you really want to do is protect EAP from hackers listening in. To do this, they came up with Protected EAP, or PEEP. As the name suggests, the EAP traffic is encrypted. Using PEEP, a hacker will not be able to make sense of any data that is transmitted, regardless of which protocol is used with PEEP. You can see how bolting on a protocol like MSChAP version 2 onto PEEP can make the protocol a lot more secure. Once you have determined which protocol you are going to use to authenticate the user, the next step is to create a tunnel back to the office which will be used to transfer your data. You may be thinking, if you used PEEP, why not use the protected tunnel that is already created? What happens in a lot of cases is very large keys are used for authenticating the user, making it very secure. Once you have a secure channel, you can use smaller keys for the tunnel. The advantage of this is that it puts a lot less load on your device. This method is still quite secure, even with the use of smaller keys, because the initial higher level of encryption prevents these keys from being decrypted. Now that you understand some of the protocols that are used in remote connections, let's have a look at how to create a remote connection in Windows 7 between two computers. To create a new remote connection, I need to open Network and Sharing Center. This can be opened through the control panel, but in this case, I will open it through the sys tray. Once Network and Sharing Center is open, select the option Set Up a New Connection or Network. This will run the new connection wizard. There are many different connections that can be set up from this wizard. For example, you could configure your initial connection to the internet or connect to a new wireless network. In this case, I will select the option Connect to a Workplace, since I want to connect to a different computer directly. The wizard will give you the option to use your internet connection to create a VPN connection to the other computer. If you needed to, you could also select the second option, Dial Directly, if you want to use dial-up. In this case, I will use my existing internet connection. The next screen will ask me if I want to set up an internet connection. Because this computer is on a test network, Windows 7 has not been able to detect that an internet connection does exist. For this reason, I will select the option Set Up an Internet Connection Later. On the next screen, I can enter in the name of the other computer that I want to connect to, or the IP address. You should also set a destination name. This will appear to the user, so you should make it a friendly name. If you are using smart cards, you can configure them here. If you are using a shared computer, you should tick the option Allow Other People to Use This Connection. This will allow other users on the computer to use this connection. If you choose the option to save the password, other users on the computer can use this connection without the need to enter in a username and password. On the next screen, you can enter in the username and password for the connection and a domain name if required. The new connection is now ready to be used. If I select Change Adapter Settings, I can see any network adapter on my computer as well as the new connection I made. Windows 7 will hopefully automatically detect the settings to use. However, if you do need to change them, you can do so from the properties of the connection. On the General tab, you can change the name of the computer or IP address the connection will be connecting to. If I go to the Options tab, you have some additional options. If you don't need to log on to a domain controller, you can clear the option Include Windows Logon Domain. If the connection is trying to log onto a domain that does not exist, this can increase the time the connection takes to establish. On the Security tab, you will notice the type of tunnel is set to Automatic. Windows will attempt to work out which type of tunnel to use. In most cases, you will not need to change this. If you have problems with the connection establishing itself, you can change it to point-to-point, layer-to-tunneling protocol, SSTP, or IPsec to ensure the correct tunnel type is used. For the data encryption option, you can switch off encryption, have it optional, require it, or require the best encryption available. Remember that VPN tunnels have two parts. When the tunnel is created, the password will be encrypted and the user authenticated. If you decided to switch off data encryption, you will get better performance. Without data encryption, a hacker will only be able to intercept your data, but your username and password will still be encrypted. If you decide to change these options, it is a matter of deciding if you can afford the performance hit added by the higher encryption levels. Having said that, modern computers can perform encryption without a noticeable performance penalty. The deciding factor in most cases will be if the computer or device on the other side can handle the level of encryption, especially if it is required to handle a lot of connections at once. Down at the bottom, you can determine the protocols that will be used to authenticate the connection. Disabled by default, you can select Unencrypted Password using PAP. I would not recommend this unless in a test environment, as most systems nowadays should at least support the next option of CHAP. CHAP is an open standard, so is supported by non-Microsoft systems. Even though it is an older standard, you may need it to connect to non-Microsoft devices. The next option, MSChap version 2, is a newer standard and is more secure. MSChap version 2 is a Microsoft standard, so is only supported on Microsoft systems. On the Networking tab, you can select which protocols and services will be available. You could disable IP version 4 if you did not require it. A more common option is to disable file sharing or client for Microsoft networks. File and printer sharing is required if you want to share your files and printers across the connection. Client for Microsoft networks is required if you want to connect to printers and shares over the connection. On the last tab, the Sharing tab, you can configure internet connection sharing. This allows other computers on the local network to use this computer to connect to the internet. This is usually used on home networks where one computer has access to the internet and the device connecting to the internet cannot be shared directly. For example, the device is a USB DSL device or a PCI card inside the computer. If you want to establish a connection, right-click on the connection and press Connect. However, it is generally easier for users to go to the sys tray and select the networking icon. Here you can see the connection I just made. If the user has wireless networks available as well to connect to, they will show up here. All I need to do now is enter in the username and password and press Connect. The connection will be made between this computer and the other computer and is ready to use. This concludes how to use Windows 7 to make remote connections. In the next video, I will look at Windows updates. Windows updates allows your computer to connect to Microsoft and download all the latest patches and updates. The whole process can be automated. If you have enjoyed this free training video for Windows 7, please feel free to visit our webpage or YouTube channel to get more free videos. All our videos are free of charge and easily available on YouTube for you to watch. Thanks for watching.